Hi, this is Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at InterArbor Solutions, and you're listening to Briefings Direct. Our next IT Operations Strategy Panel discussion explores how the IT for IT reference architecture for IT management creates demonstrated business benefits in many ways across many types of organizations. Since its delivery in 2015 by the Open Group, IT for IT is focused on defining, sourcing, consuming and managing services across the IT function's value stream to its stakeholders. Among its earliest and most ardent users are IT vendors, startups, and global professional services providers. To learn more about how this variety of highly efficient businesses and their IT organizations make the most of IT for IT, often as a complementary mix of frameworks and methodologies, we are now joined by our panel. We're here with Lars Arasen, fellow at Micro Focus in Copenhagen. Mark Bodman, Senior Product Manager at ServiceNow in Austin, Texas. John Essler, Client Principal at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise Point Next in Denver. Rob Asershok, IT Architect at Fruition Partners, a DXC technology company in Amsterdam. Varun Vijay Kumar, Associate General Manager and ITSM Architect at HCL Technologies in Raleigh-Durham, and Gerard Bennett, CEO and co-founder at Dremptsoft in San Diego. Welcome to you all. Big trends are buffeting businesses in 2019. Companies of all kinds need to attain digital transformation faster, make their businesses more intelligent and responsive in their markets, and improve end-user experiences. So software development, applications life cycles, and optimizing how IT departments operate are more important than ever. And they need to operate as a coordinated team, not in silos. Lars, why is the IT for IT standard so powerful, given these requirements that most businesses now face?
There's a number of reasons why it's so powerful, but I think the starting point is the fact that it's actually truly end-to-end. It starts from the planning stage. How do you convert your strategy into actionable projects that is being measured in the right manner, all the way through development, through delivery of the service into how you consume it and run it at the end of the day? There are many other frameworks. They are very often very process-oriented or capability-oriented, but this actually gives you a framework that can underpin it all. So every IT needs to have such a framework in place and be rationalized and well-integrated on it, and IT for IT deliver that.
And IT for IT is designed to help IT organizations elevate themselves in terms of how they operate and the impact they can have in the overall business. Mark, when you encounter somebody and they say, IT for IT, what is that? What's your elevator pitch? How would you best describe this so a lay audience can understand it?
So I usually pitch it as a framework for managing IT and leave it at that. And depending on who it is I'm talking to, I might actually say operating model, because that's something a CIO or even a business person might know. And if it's an individual contributor down in one of the value streams, I'll say it's a broader framework than what you're doing, right? So if they're a dev ops guy, or maybe a safe guy, or even a test engineer, right? I kind of explain it that it's a more comprehensive framework, and it goes back to sort of the nature of IT for IT being sort of a hub of many different frameworks and all kind of designed as one architecture.
Is there an analog to other business or even cultural occurrences that IT for IT is to an enterprise what blank is to blank? How would you describe this in comparison to some other orchestration capability? Lars?
The analog I have is that you go to Lord of the Rings, and IT for IT is the ring to rule them all. It's the one that actually combines everything you need.
Why do companies need this now? What are the problems that they're facing that requires one framework to rule them all?
What I'm seeing out in a lot of our clients is they've implemented a lot of different kinds of software, automation software, orchestration software, portals. They're sharing more information, more data, but they haven't changed their operating model. And using IT for IT is a good way to see where your gaps are, what you're doing good, what you're not doing not so good, and how to improve. It gives you a really good foundation on knowing the business of IT.
Yes, Jared.
Just to add on to that, I think what we're hearing in the field is that IT departments are generally drowning at this point. You've got a myriad of factors, some of which are their fault and some of which aren't. The compliance world is getting nightmarishly strict. The privacy laws that are coming in are straining what are already resource-constrained organizations. Budgets are being cut. The other side of it is the users are demanding more from IT as a strategic element as opposed to simply a support organization. And so as a result, they're drowning on a daily basis. And as you said, their operating model is they're still running on wooden wheels, in effect. They have not changed any of the foundational elements. If your family has a spending problem, you don't stop spending. You first go run a budget. You put an Excel spreadsheet. You get all the data into one place. You pull it together. You figure out what's going on, and then you can execute change. That's really what we do from an IT perspective, is simply get everything in the same place. Let's all get on the same page and talk to the same language. Then we can start executing change to really survive what is this torrent of change that's happening in IT out from under us.
Because IT in the past perhaps could operate in silos and there'd be specialization. Now we have to get that team sport approach. Mark, how does IT for IT help that?
Yeah, and I think the analog is really the doctor's profession. You've got specialists and you've got generalists, right? You go to the generalist when you don't really know where the problem is. You got a problem. Then you go to the specialist that has a very specific skill set and tools to kind of go deep. And I think IT for IT is really aimed at that generalist layer with pointers to the specialist.
So IT for IT has been public and available since October of 2015. It's been a few years in the market. We're now seeing different types of adoption patterns, small to medium-sized businesses, enterprises. What are the rubber hits the road points where the value is compelling and understood that then drives this into the organization? Varun, where do you see this as an accelerant to business improvement?
I mean, when we look at the industry in general, there are a lot of disruptive innovations in terms of cloud computing taking a hold, and then you have these other frameworks like big data and all of these, which are actually driving a paradigm shift in the way IT is perceived. So IT is not only just a supporting function to the business anymore, it's a business enabler and a competitive driver. So that is where you need a lot of stability when it comes to IT, and IT needs to function with the same level of rigor like how you would look at a banking industry or a manufacturing industry, for example. If you look at those business lines, they already have reference architectures spanning several decades already. And that was something which was missing in IT. And that is where IT for IT fills this gap, and we have come up with a reference architecture. And what this basically does is when you implement solutions, tooling solutions, when you come up with enterprise applications, you don't need to necessarily rip apart and replace them. You would still be able to use that underpinning architecture and be able to retain most of the things even when you actually advance to a different solution. Mm-hmm. So that is where I think a lot of value gets created.
John?
The one thing you have to remember, too, is that it's not all this new stuff. It's not about AI or Internet of Things, big data, all that kind of stuff. That's the new shiny stuff. There's still a lot of old stuff out there that has to be managed the same way. And so you have to be able to have a framework, which IT for IT is, that allows you to have that hybrid environment and be able to still manage it all.
The framework to rule all frameworks, Lars.
Yeah. Yes, and that also goes back to the concept of multimode IT. And that's fine. And some people say, okay, I have new tools for the new way of doing stuff, and then I keep my old tools for the old stuff. But in the real world, these things need to work together. The services depend on each other. You have a smart banking app, but you still have a COBOL mainframe application that it needs to communicate with. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have a single way of managing these two worlds, you cannot keep up the speed and stability and security that goes along with it.
One of the things that impresses me a lot about IT for IT is that almost any kind of organization can find value and use it from the get-go. So let's go downstream, a small to medium-sized business. Jared, where are you seeing the value that IT for IT brings to them?
Small to mid-sized businesses have less pain, but it's proportionally it's the same exact problem, right? The larger enterprises have enormous pain, the mid-sized guys have a medium. And it's the same pain. It's the same mess. It's just just orders of magnitude smaller. So it's a little bit more manageable, a little bit more changeable. And steering that boat, like we talked about earlier, is easier to do. So from a small to mid-sized perspective, I would argue they actually have an opportunity to get a lot more value proportionally, simply because they can implement a lot more of this a lot faster and perhaps even rip up the floor in the foundation and start over. Whereas, you know, kind of a greenfield approach, whereas most large organizations simply will not have that capability. So that level of adoption we're seeing, and I think what we were alluding to earlier, these kind of mounting coming problems and hitting us, big data, how much data is going to be created in the next 5 years versus the last 5 years? I mean, that's universal, small, medium, large, everyone's having these problems. So they all see the writing on the wall, and I think the vast majority of them are prefer to get ahead of it if you can convince them that this is the foundation they needed to start with to begin with.
Mm-hmm. At the other end of the scale, Mark, big multinational corporations, sprawling IT departments, thousands of developers, they need to rationalize, they need to think about maybe limiting the number of tools, finding the fit-for-purpose approach. How does IT for IT help them?
It really helps to understand where are the areas to rationalize, first of all, what's important, because you're not going to do everything at once, and you're going to focus on your biggest pain points. Now, the other element is the legacy element, which is you can't change everything at once. There's going to be some more, you know, I would say bigger rocks, and then some smaller rocks. And then there's areas where there's innovation. You're going to be seeing folks innovate, especially when it comes to the whole DevOps movement, right, and maybe new languages, new platforms that you're deploying new capabilities. On. So what we allow you to do now is to interchange those parts, right? A big value proposition of IT for IT is standardizing these components, but also the interfaces, so that you can change out one whole component and not disrupt the entire value chain.
Rob, complexity is inherent in IT. You can't be a good IT department without being a very complex IT department. They have a lot on their plate. How does IT for IT help them manage complexity, not do away with it, but manage it?
Yeah, you're right. In a larger IT organization, there's a growing complexity. It even grows more and more. We have more services to manage, more vendors, more change and release, more IT data. So it only gets more complex. And that's why it is essential in a larger IT organization, or even if any size, to maybe structurize and standardize how do you manage IT in a broader perspective, like creating a bigger picture. Most organizations have multiple teams working on different tools, components in the whole value chain. So maybe have specialized people for security, even for monitoring or the service desk, for development and for risk and compliance and portfolio management. And they tend to optimize their own silo with their own practices. And that's what IT for IT can help you with, creating a bigger picture how everything should be connected and could be connected.
John?
So I've actually used IT for IT to help get rid of those silos. And the way I did it was in a common thing that a lot of companies, consulting in particular, do is in a workshop format. And so I took the reference architecture from IT for IT, and I got a certain number of people, and I was very specific about the people I wanted in the room with me, because I know that in doing this kind of thing, you have to have the right people in the room. And so we had their service management people, we had security, we had infrastructure, we had network, just about a whole broad range across IT. And we got them around a table, and I took them through the reference architecture. And what they started to see as I started to describe each of these words, which meant function, then they started to talk amongst themselves to say, yeah, I have this piece of that, I have this piece of this, you have that piece of that, and this piece of this. And so what it did was it started to let them think about the functions that they as a group are performing, not the individual piece like service management or infrastructure.
Naris, now, IT for IT might want to be organizing and managing, but it's not muscling out other aspects of IT. So ITIL and TOGAF and SAFE, there's a harmonization opportunity here. How does IT for IT fit in to a larger context among all these other powerful tools and approaches and methodologies that organizations look to?
That's an excellent question, especially given that a lot of people, if you are really much into SAFE, you would look at IT for IT, that's something different, I don't need it. SAFE is solving my world problem, basically. But then once you get to discuss it, you see, well, SAFe doesn't give you any recommendation about how tools need to be connected together to create that automated pipeline that SAFe relies on. So it actually complements SAFe well. And that's the same story again and again with the other ones, frameworks like ITIL. And it also implies that if you have an organization where you have a development organization that starts working on SAFe, but you have a run organization that is really using ITIL, then IT for IT can help bring those two things together without changing either one of the organizations. Really, they still ITIL can be relevant for the help desk, et cetera, and SAFe can still function, and they can collaborate.
Varun, another important aspect to maturity and capability for IT organizations is to become more DevOps-oriented. How does DevOps benefit from IT for IT? What's the relationship?
When we talk about DevOps, typically organizations focus on the entire service design lifecycle and then how it moves into transition, right? But the relationship between how a service actually gets conceptualized to how it is then translated into a design sometimes tends to get lost. So we need to utilize IT for IT in order to establish the traceability, make sure that all the artifacts and all the information basically flows through the pipeline and across the IT value chain. So when we look at IT for IT, the way we position this framework to organizations and customers is very important. A lot of times people ask me, is this going to replace ITIL or how is it actually different from DevOps? So I think the simplest way to answer those questions is to kind of tell them that this is not something which provides you narrative guidance. It's not a process framework, but rather an information framework. So we are essentially prescribing the way data needs to flow across the entire IT value chain, how information needs to get exchanged, and how that integration is established. And that is very vital to having an effective DevOps framework, because you are essentially relying on having traceability and ensuring that people are receiving the right kind of information in order to accept those services and then start supporting those services once they're designed.
All right, let's start thinking about the adoption of where IT for IT is compelling, maybe at a small scale, but that leads to wider appreciation of its power. So, Jared, are there any tactical pain points in some of your customers where you can bring in something like IT for IT concepts and approaches that helps them that then would lead to a wider appreciation?
Sure. I'll give you an example. I hate the word, but synergy is all over this thing, right? Breaking down these silos and having all this stuff in one place, or at least in one process, one information framework, helps all of these kind of the nuanced processes on top get better. The classic one is the agile development. Everybody, development runs in a silo. They sit in a black box, generally in another building somewhere, and their entire methodology of getting more efficient is simply to work faster. So they implement sprints or agile or scrum or, you know, name it, whatever. And what you recognize is they didn't actually have a resource problem. They have a throughput problem. And the throughput problem can be slightly solved using some of these methodologies by squeezing a little bit more out of their guys. But what you find really is they're developing the wrong things. They don't have a strategic element to their business. They simply develop whatever the heck they decide is important, and now they develop it really efficiently. But the output out the other side is still not very beneficial to the business. You input a little bit of strategy in the front of that and get the business to decide what it is we want you developing, and all of a sudden your throughput goes through the roof simply because you've now broken down that barrier and brought those two together. And it doesn't take a lot. A little bit of demand management with an approval process can make development 50% more efficient if you can simply get them working on what's important. We continue kind of stabbing at these small little problems, but no one has really, until now, backed up and said, okay, time out. There's a lot more to this information that we need. And you take inspiration from the manufacturing plants in the 80s. Making the engine conveyor line faster isn't going to help if you're building the wrong engines or you can't get parts in. You've got to view it holistically. And then once you view it holistically and get a little bit in place, now we can go make all the lines work a little bit faster. Do that, and sky's the limit.
So simultaneous IT operations. On a large scale, Mark, at ServiceNow, you all like to see IT for IT in the marketplace because, gee, it's complementary to your products and services. A well-greased IT machine means a very good ITSM environment. But you're also using this internally. You're a consumer, not just going to market with it. Tell us how IT for IT helps ServiceNow be a better company.
A lot of the activity, of course, for ServiceNow is creating the products that we sell on the market, obviously. And we do use the product, as you state, right? And what we're able to do is as we break down silos across the products, as a product manager, a lot of my job is interfacing with other product managers, dealing with those integration points, right? The data, having the data discussions. And so as we make the product better, we automatically make our IT organization better because we're consuming it, right? We're customer zero is our IT shop, and we deploy our products to manage our products. So it's a very nice, natural, recursive relationship that we have with our own company. As the company gets better at product management and products, our company can get more product out there, right? And that's, I think, the goal for many IT shops, right? You're not creating IT for IT's sake. You're creating IT to provide products to your customers at the end of the day.
Rob, at Fruition Partners, DXC company, you have clients that are using this. You have a use case that comes to mind that is very demonstrative of the power and the way that this should be started, you know, in inception point that then leads to a larger light goes off of how powerful it can be.
Yeah, I have a good example of an insurance organization where they have been forced to reduce the FTE for 50% and reduce the cost significantly to develop and maintain IT services. And so what they have achieved initially, they said, well, we are working on it. So yeah, that's what they said, right? We have their DevOps movement in it. We're going to automate. We've got a monitoring system. We have agile backlog tools and all the things. So when I showed IT for IT, they said, well, we're already doing that. And I said, why didn't you have the results yet? And they said, well, we're working on it. Come 3 months later, come back. But after that period of time, they were not succeeding the speed because they need to speed up, right? They can maybe wait another 3 years, but that was they need to do it quickly. And then we said, use IT for IT. Take a specific application teams that move to the cloud, in this case, Azure Cloud. Show that you can do it end-to-end from strategy into operations, end-to-end in 3 months' time and demonstrate that it works. It saves you time. Get transparency. And that's what has been done. And with that outcome, they realized, oh, we didn't have never be able to achieve that if they continue the way we did it in the past.
John, at HPE PointNext, you're involved with digital transformation, sort of the highest of the strategic endeavors, but among the most important for companies nowadays. When you're in an environment that you're trying to actually transform an organization to become more digital, data-driven, intelligent, responsive, how does IT for IT help?
So when these companies are doing all these big strategic things and trying to become a digital enterprise, so they implement all these tools that are going to help them do this, right? Automation and orchestration tools to help make things go faster and get more out. But what happens is they forget about the operating model underneath, and they don't see the value. They're expecting a big drug company I worked with, they were expecting 30% reduction after implementing all these tools in cost, and they didn't get it. And they're scratching their heads, why? So we went in and we used IT for IT as a foundation to help them understand where they need to change, in addition to some tools that HP has that help them understand across different domains, depending on the level of service they want to provide to their customers, then what do I need to change? What does that look like when it's all said and done?
Lars at Micro Focus, 4,000 to 5,000 developers, a great deal of requirement to put software out in a timely fashion. How has IT for IT helped you internally, consuming it, using it, been a better developer?
Well, the main thing is that we again used what is now almost a standard technique with IT for IT to do tool rationalization. And so going in, painting the picture of as is and to be, and then simply just converting. Over a year, we managed to convert it all into a single tool chain that 80% of the developers are on. And with that, we are now much more agile in delivering products to market. We can do much more sharing across. So instead of a release every year, we can do it easily every 3 months. But we also have hot fixes and change requests coming in. So we probably have 20 releases a day. And on top of that, we can do a lot of sharing on components, so we can align much more to a common strategy around how all our products are being developed and delivered to our customers. So massive change.
Before we close out, I'd like to think about the future a little bit, because we've established that IT for IT has backwards compatibility, if you will. That is to say, if you're a highly legacy-oriented IT department, this can be very powerful for you. But there's so many new things coming on There's AI ops. There's more artificial intelligence, machine learning, and data-driven and analytics-driven requirements across most business applications. We're also finding that the hybrid cloud, multi-cloud, complexity across deployments, models for apps and data is increasing in complexity. And then managing the cost of that, getting insight into how to best operate across a hybrid IT environment, all very important. So let's take a pause and say, okay, how does IT for IT operate as a powerful influence 2-3 years from now? Is it something that has got future-proof benefits, Jared?
Nothing's future-proof, but I would argue the fact that we really needed this 20 years ago and didn't have it, and we're in a pretty big mess at the moment, is pretty good evidence of the fact that this is going to last a while. There's nothing magical here. I mean, it's been well thought out and well written, but there's nothing new in there. It's really just how it ought to have been for a while, and it took a group of guys to get together and really sit down and architect that out. But if you look at it end to end, I mean, you probably theoretically could have done this in the 80s and had it still been relevant for the most part, because they were doing almost the exact same thing. You know, nothing new in IT. There really isn't anything new in IT. There's lots of newfangled toys and whatnot, but that's all just minutia. The reality, the foundation hasn't changed forever. I would argue that, you know, in 2040, this thing will still be relevant.
Varun, do you feel that organizations that adopt and use IT for IT are in a better position to grok and adopt and implement and benefit from newer technologies and approaches?
Yeah, definitely. Because IT for IT, although it caters to the traditional IT operating models, I think it also introduces a lot of new concepts which were not in existence earlier. So if you look at some of the concepts like service brokering, catalog aggregation, bringing in the role of a service integrator. So all of these are things which may have been in existence in some shape or form, but there was no real structure around it. So it provides a consolidated framework for us to embrace all of these capabilities and to drive such improvements in the industry. And coupled with advances in computing, where everything gets delivered on the fly, the end users and consumers expect a lot more out of IT, and I think it helps in that direction as well.
Lars, looking to the future, how do you think IT for IT will be appreciated in a context of a highly data-driven organization?
Well, first off, IT for IT was a data architecture to begin with. So in that sense, it was the first time that IT itself's got a data architecture that was generic. So hopefully that gives it a lot of future. I also like to think about it as it's like the roads we're building, right? So we now have the roads to do whatever we want to do. And eventually you stop caring about it. It just is there. So I hope that 20 years from now, nobody discusses it.
Another important aspect to running a well-greased operation in IT, despite the complexity and despite the growing responsibility that they have, is to better organize and understand yourself, the data models about IT, not just providing data services to other parts of the enterprise or organization, but being more data thoughtful, data intense yourselves. Do you see that IT for IT oriented shops might have an advantage when it comes to having a data model about IT, understanding processes, measuring things better? Mark.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things we just produced within the forum is a reporting and KPIs guidance. So we're able to kind of show you what kind of KPIs you can get from the data model and be very prescriptive about it. I think what's happened in the past, there's been different camps and different ways of measuring and doing things. And of course, it's hard to kind of benchmark yourself. And that's really important to have some consistency there and in a way to improve it. The second part of that is and there is something new in IT for IT that I think is real fundamental, which is the value stream that is a request to fulfill. It's now a top-line thing to be self-service, to have self-service, to be able to engage IT in a way that's in a catalog, easy to consume, or focused on that experience. And I think that's an element that has been missing from a legacy perspective. It was out there in pockets, but now it's kind of baked in. And it goes back to some earlier comments where it's just fabric. It's taught in schools, and you just basically implement it.
Lars?
And just to compliment on the R2F request to fulfill part is that this is really what allows an IT organization to transform from being a cost center that just do whatever people ask them to do to become a service provider first and eventually a service broker, which is where you really want to be.
John.
So I started in this industry in mainframe days. The concept of a shared service was prevalent, time sharing, right? Mm-hmm. So it's the same thing. It hasn't really changed. And it's evolved. It's going through different changes, but the advent of the PC in the 80s didn't change the model that much. Now with, you know, hyperconvergence, it's moving back to that mainframe-like thing where you define a machine by software, right? You define a data center by software. So it's still a mainframe, just a bunch of stuff.
All right. For those who have been listening and reading and are intrigued by IT for IT, would like to learn more about how it could help their organization, Rob, where can they go and how can they get started in finding out, where the rubber hits the road?
Yeah, the best way to start is go to the Open Group website. It's opengroup.org/IT4IT, where there's a lot of information where you can find more about reference architecture itself, case studies, video materials on YouTube. How to get started is typically you can do that very small. You take a look at the materials and try to understand how you currently operate your IT organization and plot it to the reference architecture. That gives you immediate insight of, okay, what are my hotspots that I'm potentially missing? Do I have duplicate areas? And then try to plot the current initiatives, what you're already doing. And hopefully you realize, oh, there's so much going on at this moment already in my IT organization. I'm missing a picture because I should have a picture already on the wall somewhere. This is where we want to go to. And that's the first step. Try to create, co-create with your own organization that bigger picture. Okay, where do we want to go to? And then start doing that.
I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. You've been listening to a sponsored Briefings Direct discussion on how the IT for IT reference architecture for IT management creates demonstrated business benefits in many ways across many different types of organizations. And we've learned a variety of ways that IT for IT defines, sources, and manages services across the IT function's value stream to its stakeholders. So please join me in thanking our panelists. We've been here with Lars Rossen, Fellow at Micro Focus in Copenhagen, Mark Bodman, Senior Product Manager at ServiceNow, John Essler, Client Principal at Hewlett-Packard Enterprise Point Next, Rob Ashishok, IT Architect at Fruition Partners, a DXC technology company, Varun Vijaykumar, Associate General Manager and ITSM Architect at HCL Technologies, and Gerard Bennett, CEO and co-founder at Dreamsoft. And a big thank you as well to our audience for joining this Briefings Direct Modern Digital Business Innovation discussion. I'm Dana Gardner, Principal Analyst at Inter Arbor Solutions, your host throughout this series of Briefings Direct discussions sponsored by The Open Group. Thanks again for listening. Please pass this on to your IT community and do come back next time.